I guess I knew this day would come. The day I'd have to bury a friend. Maybe my best friend. We've been through a lot together. Some ugly moments. Remember when props came in? The ventriloquism scare of 84. Sure, there were times when people would make fun of you, imitating you. Hey, did you ever notice? What's the deal with this? Who are these people?
Who are these people?
Stop, you're gonna make me go.
They say the hardest thing for a person to do is bury a loved one. But those people never had material like this. The Tide commercial. If you've got a t-shirt with bloodstains all over it, maybe laundry isn't your biggest problem right now.
I don't understand it. He walks away from his show, he walks away from his act. Are you sure this kid is Jewish?
No, he's Jewish. Don't ask me how I know.
It's just such a waste. I mean, it all works.
Is there any cake?
Gary, what are you doing?
Listen, I got nothing on the post office. All right, Taylor.
Okay.
Thanks.
Get out of here.
Did you ever see his act?
No, not really, man. Did you?
Yeah, yeah. He was good.
But I was full of drugs. Ed, did you ever see his act?
Oh, he did The Tonight Show many, many times. But no.
Jay, thanks a lot for being here. This really means a lot.
Yeah, hey, listen, when can you do the show again, huh?
Well, but I just retired all my material.
Hey, is Carlos still around?
Why is it the best landscaping in the neighborhood? It's always in a cemetery. Everybody's dead.
That's funny. You gonna do that?
Do what?
A bit. Can I do that?
Well, that's not a bit. I'm just saying it.
I'm gonna do that, okay?
No, you can't do it. It's my bit.
Yeah, come on. It's a bit. It's anybody's bit who does it.
No, but I said it first.
You know, come to think of it, I've been doing it for a while anyway.
Jerry, Alan King would like to meet you on his territory. He'll guarantee security.
Okay. Sorry, kid. I don't do this joke anymore.
Oh, come on.
Look, I'm sorry. It's over.
But this is a solid bit. Please.
All right. But I'm telling you for the last time.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jerry Seinfeld. Thank you. Thank you.
That was very, very nice. Thank you very much. Thank you. Standing ovation. Now I know there's always a... Excuse me? Perfect start, sure. Thank you. I know it's not easy for an audience to give a standing ovation. There's always a few people that don't really want to do it. I've seen those people, you know, they're always like... Are we doing this now? So anyway, I'm thrilled to be back here in New York. I love how certain things about New York never change. They're always constant. They're always there for you. The cabbies and the B.O. What is with the B.O. and these guys? How long are these shifts? Can't we get this man a 10-minute break for a shower? You're in the back. It's coming through the glass. You're just going, what in the world? And then I love when they put that cherry poppet stuff on the dashboard. So you get the cherry B.O. I don't know what that's supposed to be. Even fruit showers more often than this. The funny thing to me about being in these cabs is that when you're in Manhattan, for some reason, you don't get scared no matter how fast the guy goes. Well, you know, he's driving fast and recklessly, but well, he's a professional. He's got a cab driver's license. I can see it right there. I don't even know what it takes to get a cab driver's license. I think all you need is a face. This seems to be their big qualification. No blank heads are allowed driving cabs in this town. Also helps to have a name with like 8 consonants in a row. You ever see some of the letters in these names? What is the O with the line through it, by the way? What planet is that from? You need a chart of the elements if you want to report the guy. Yes, officer, his name was Amal, and then the symbol for boron. No, it was not manganese. I had the periodic chart with me at the time. But I love to travel. I love it, whether it's a car or it's a plane. I like to get out there. I like to keep it moving. I love airports. Feel safe in airports, thanks to the high-caliber individuals we have working at X-Ray Security. How about this crack squad of savvy, motivated personnel? The way you want to set up your airport security is you want the short, heavy-set woman at the front with the skin-tight uniform. That's your first line of defense. You want those pants so tight, the flap in front of the zipper has pulled itself open. You can see the metal tangs hanging on for dear life. Then you put the bag on the conveyor belt, goes to the little luggage car wash. Then you have that other genius down at the other end looking in the little X-ray TV screen. This Einstein has chosen to stand in front of X-rays 14 hours a day as his profession. Looking in that thing. I have looked in that TV screen. I cannot make out one object. He's standing there. What is that, a hair dryer with a scope on it? That looks okay. Keep it moving. Some sort of bowling ball candle. Yeah, I got no problem with that. Just, you know, we don't want to hold up the line. So I go to the bathroom in the airport. What is the story on the sinks in airport bathrooms, that they will not give us a twisted-on, twisted-off human-style faucet? Is that too risky for the general population? Too dangerous? We better install the one-handed, spring-loaded, pain-in-the-ass Alcatraz-style faucets. You know those ones where you gotta go, hey, boy, I got a little water there. Oh, another couple drops. What is it that they think we would do with a faucet? Turn them all on full, run out into the parking lot, laughing, pushing each other into the bushes. Come on, the water's on, let's go. I turned it on full blast. You idiot, we're businessmen. We're gonna miss our plane. Who cares? Water! That's how they think we'll behave.
Do the people that work in these little shops in the airport have any idea what the prices are every place else in the world? Yeah, $14 tuna sandwich. We think that's fair. That's what we charge in our country. Then you get on the plane. Pilot, of course, always has to come on the PA system. This guy's so excited about being a pilot, he can't even stand himself. Well, I'm going to take it up to about 20,000. Then I'm going to make a left by Pittsburgh. Then I'm going to make a right by Chicago. Then I'm going to bring it down to 15,000. You know, he's giving you the whole route, all his moves. We're in the back going, yeah, fine, that's all. You know, just do whatever the hell you got to do. I don't know. End up where it says on the ticket, really, is our only concern. Do I bother him with what I'm doing, knocking on the cockpit door? I'm having the peanuts now. Yeah, that's what we're doing back here. Thought I'd keep you posted. I'm not going to have them all now. I'm just going to have a few. I don't want to finish it because it's such a big bag. Then the stewardesses have to come out. They have to do their little emergency equipment show. You know, that thing they do. One of them reads it. The other one acts it out. Hey, we have seat belts and oxygen masks. Things for you to use. They show you how to use a seatbelt in case you haven't been in a car since 1965. Oh, you lift up on the buckle. Oh. I was trying to break the metal apart. I thought that's how it works. I was going to try and tear the fabric part of the belt. I thought if I could just get it started. Then they always point out the emergency exits. It's always with that very vague point, though, isn't it? Where the hell would these places be, would you say? Planes at a 90-degree angle, your hair is on fire, you're looking for this. How do you think you're gonna do there? She's thinking, I'm getting out before you're getting out. You're dead, you're dead, I'm gone. Then they always have to close that first class curtain, too. And they always give you that little look. Maybe if you had worked a little harder, I wouldn't have to do this. It's a whole tiny world on the airplane, isn't it? There's always that little tiny table there, tiny computer, everyone's in a little cramped seat, tiny food, tiny utensils, tiny liquor bottles, tiny bathroom, tiny sink, tiny mirror, tiny faucets. So it's a small problem, gonna be a slight delay, we're gonna be a little late. I always go in the airplane bathroom. Even if I don't have to go, I gotta go in there. It's nice, it's like your own little apartment on the plane, isn't it? Go in there, lock the door, the light comes on after a second. It's like a little surprise party. But I'm always impressed with the amount of equipment that they have in that place. I mean, it's little, but they got the tissues, towels, closets, compartments, tiny slot for used razor blades. They always have that. Who is shaving on the plane? And shaving so much, they're using up razor blades? Is this what's happening? What, is the Wolfman flying in there, for Christ's sakes? Who could shave that much? Arr. So I'm supposed to go down to Florida next week after we're done here. That's where all my relatives live. I don't really want to go. Florida, a lot of old people down there. You know, they live in those minimum security prisons. That's where they put all the old people. What's with all the security there with the guard gate, with the arm coming down? Everyone's got a uniform, guns. Are the old people trying to escape, or are people stealing old people? What is the security problem? I just can't drive around there. You know how the old people drive? They drive slow, they sit low. That is their motto. State flag of Florida should be just a steering wheel with a hat and two knuckles on it. And that left turn signal on for when they left the house that morning. That's a legal turn in Florida. It's known as an eventual left. You can signal this week, turn any following year of your life. What is that age that old people reach where they decide when they back out of a driveway, they're not looking anymore? You know how they do that? They just go, well, I'm old and I'm coming back. I survive. Let's see if you can. One thing I do like about being with my older relatives is it makes me feel like a kid again. You know, they're feeding you. You're trying to steal candy. Candy was my whole life when I was a kid. That was first 10 years of my life. I think the only clear thought I had was get candy. That was it. Family, friends, school. They're just obstacles in the way of the candy. I'm out for the candy here. I'm just thinking, get candy, get candy, get candy, get candy, get candy. That's why you have to teach kids not to take candy from a stranger if they're playing in a playground, because they're such candy moron idiot brains. They're just, this man has candy, I'm going with him, goodbye, I don't care what happens to me, get candy, get candy, get candy, get candy. Don't go, they'll torture you, they'll kidnap you, it doesn't matter, he has an O. Henry, I have to take that chance. Get candy, get candy, get candy. So the first time you hear the concept of Halloween when you're a kid, your brain can't even process the information. You can, you're like, what is this? What did you say? So what did you say about giving out candy? Who was giving out candy? Everyone that we know is just giving out candy? Are you kidding me? When is this happening? Where? Why? Take me with you. I gotta be a part of this. I'll do anything that they want. I can wear that. I'll wear anything I have to wear. I'll do anything I have to do to get the candy from those fools that are so stupidly giving it away. So the first couple of years, I made my own costumes, which of course suck, the ghost, the hobo, no good. Then finally, third year, begging the parents, got the Superman Halloween costume, not surprisingly. Cardboard box, cellophane top, mask included. Remember the rubber band on the back of that mask? That was a quality item there, wasn't it? That was good for about 10 seconds before it snapped out of that cheap little staple they put it in there with. You go to your first house, trick or snap, it broke, I don't believe it. Wait up, you guys, I gotta fix it. Hey, wait up! Wait up! That's what kids say, they don't say wait. They say wait up! Hey, wait up! Because when you're little, your life is up, the future is up, everything you want is up. Wait up, hold up, shut up. Mom, I'll clean up, let me stay up. Parents, of course, are just the opposite. Everything is down, just calm down. Slow down. Come down here, sit down, put that down. So I had my little costume, I was physically ready, I was preparing myself. I did not try on the costume prior to Halloween. Do you remember this? This is an obscure one, but on the side of the box, I remember this, on my Superman costume, it actually said, do not attempt to fly. They printed that as a warning, because kids were putting it on and going off the roofs. You know. I love the idea of the kid who's stupid enough to think he actually is Superman, but smart enough to check that box before he goes off the roof. Wait, let me see if it says anything about me being Superman. Oh, wait a second here, So anyway, but my hopes were up. I was thinking that this is probably the same exact costume that Superman wears himself. And you put these things on, it's not exactly the super fit that you are hoping for. It looks more like Superman's pajamas is what it looks like. It's all kind of loose and flowing, and the neckline kind of comes down about there. Flimsy little ribbon string in the back. Plus, my mother makes me wear my winter coat over the costume anyway. I don't recall Superman wearing a jacket. Not like I had cheap corduroy phony fur. Boy, I'm Superman, but it's a little chilly out, and I'm glad I've got this cheap little 10-year-old kid's jacket. So I'm going out, I'm trick-or-treating, but the mask, the rubber band keeps breaking, it keeps getting shorter. I'm fixing it, it's getting tighter and tighter on my face. You know when it starts slicing into your eyeballs there, and you're trying to breathe through that little hole? Getting all sweaty. I can't see, I can't breathe, we gotta keep going, we gotta get the candy. And a half hour into it, you just take that mask, oh, the hell with it! Bing bong, yeah, it's me, give me that candy. Yeah, I'm Superman, look at the pant legs, what do you care? Remember those last couple years, trick-or-treating, getting a little too old for it? Still out there going through the motions. Bing bong, come on, lady, let's go. Halloween doorbells, candy, let's pick it up in there. Come to the door, they always ask you those same stupid questions. What are you supposed to be? I'm supposed to be done by now. You want to move it along with the Three Musketeers? I got 18 houses on this block, sweetheart. Just hit the bag, we hit the road. That's the way it works. Sometimes they give you that little white bag twisted on the top. You know, that's going to be some crap candy. Doesn't have the official Halloween markings on it. Hold it, lady. Wait a second. What is this? The orange marshmallow shaped like a big peanut? Do me a favor. You keep that one. Yeah, we have all the doorstops we need already. Thank you. We're going for name candy only this year. Food is so complicated as an adult. It's just, you see people in the supermarket, they're just sweating it out. Nobody knows, what do I eat? The protein, the carbs, the fat content. Oh my God, fat content. You're just walking up to each other. You look pretty good. What are you eating? Maybe I'll eat that. The whole supermarket itself is designed to break down your sense of having any life outside the supermarket. It's like a casino. There's no clocks, no windows, no easily accessible exits. You ever not buy anything in the supermarket and try and get out of there? It's impossible. There's no way out. You can see what happens to people. When they're walking up to the supermarket, they really have a whole sense of purpose. I'm going to get this, I'm going to get that, I'm going to pay for it, I'm going to get out of here and get right back to my normal life. You see that same person 10 minutes later just... What aisle is this? Why did I come up here? I'm always noticing something new. Oh, they got them in mesquite flavor now. What is mesquite? Wonder if it's made from mosquitoes. Produce section I always find very challenging. There's always some special thing you're supposed to know, you know, about each fruit. Summertime, make sure your peaches are, I don't know, whatever it is. You gotta fake it, you know, I'm shaking stuff, holding it up to the light. Yeah, that's a good one. Sure glad I found that one. Cantaloupes, roll them down the aisle. See the way that's fading left? That one's not ready. I don't want that one. I'm very impressed with this seedless watermelon product that they have for us. They've done it. We now have seedless watermelon. Pretty amazing. What are they planting to grow the seedless watermelon, I wonder? The melons aren't humping, are they? They must be planting something. How does this work? And what kind of scientists do this type of work? I read a thing, it was 15 years in development. In the laboratories with, you know, gene splicing or whatever they do there, I don't know. I mean, other scientists working on AIDS, cancer, heart disease, these guys are going, no, I'm going to devote myself to melon. I think that's much more important. Sure, thousands are dying needlessly, but this, that's gotta stop. Can you ever try and pick up a wet one off the floor? It's almost impossible. I really think we should devote the money to these studies. Milk is a big problem for people in the supermarket. They're never quite sure if they have it, if they need it. They bury it way in the back in the supermarket. You gotta find it, you gotta hack your way through all the displays. Well, there it is. There's the milk. Do we have any milk? People are never really sure if they have milk. You think you have milk, we might have milk. I know there's a carton in there, I don't know how much is in. Well, what should we do? Because you want to be sure. There's nothing worse than thinking you have milk and not having it. You know, you got the bowl set up, the cereal, the spoon, the napkin, the TV, the newspaper, everything's ready to go. You go to lift up the carton and it's too light. Huh? Oh, no! Too light. Or sometimes you think you need milk. Hey, we better pick up some milk. Like many of you are thinking right now. You know, he's right. Maybe we should pick up some milk. So you'll pick up some milk on the way home. And then you'll discover you already had milk. And now you got way too much milk. That's no good either. Now it's a race against the clock with the expiration date. That freaky thing. Now you're eating giant punch bowls of cereal, 3 meals a day. You're washing your face with milk. Bringing cats in from all over the neighborhood. Hurry up and drink it! Come on, it's almost time! Get back over here, yeah. How do they know that that is the definite exact day? You know, they don't say like it's in the vicinity, give or take, roughly. They brand it right into the side of the cart and then they... That's your goddamn day right there. Oh, don't screw with us. We know what day is the final day. And then it is so over. You ever have milk the day after the day? Scares the hell out of you, doesn't it? The spoon is trembling as it comes out of the bowl. It's after the day! I'm taking a big chance! I smelled it, you smell it, what is it supposed to smell like? Smelled like milk to me! I don't know how they're so definite, though. Maybe the cows tip them off when they're milking them. July 3rd. The only thing tougher than the supermarket is the drugstore. The drugstore is really challenging because you have no idea what they're talking about. You know, you're just looking at ingredients. I had a cold a couple weeks ago. So I go in there and I'm looking, it's just like, the entire wall is cold medication. You know, and you can't understand anything. So you're just reading ingredients. You ever catch yourself reading ingredients in a drugstore? Oh, this has 0.03 tetrahydrozoline. That's a good amount of that. But it's so hard to figure out. Sometimes, you know, they have, like, this one's quick-acting, this one's long-lasting. When do I need to feel good? Now or later? I don't know. They always tell you how the medicine works on TV, you know, the commercials. That's my favorite part, where the guy says, here's the human body, it's always this guy. You know this guy, no face, mouth open, this is how drug companies see the public. And he's always got the tube coming down here, and then the circle area. These are the complex inner workings of the human body, I assume. I'm sure when you go to medical school, they put that up on the board the first day. Okay, everyone, now remember, you've got your tube coming down from the mouth, and that goes into your circle area. That's pretty much all we know. That's it for today. Don't miss tomorrow. We're going to practice making people wait in a little room in their underwear. And then you'll all be doctors. That's all there is to it. Then they have to show you the pain. You know that part where they say, here's where you hurt. Pain is usually represented by some sort of lightning attacking the guy. Glowing redness is popular. Sometimes parts of the guy's body will just burst into flames. Sometimes the whole guy is like out of focus. I never had a doctor say to me, are you having any pain? Yes, I am. Are you having any lightning with the pain? Have you been in a funhouse mirror at any time? Then they tell you about the pain-relieving ingredient. There's always got to be a lot of that. Nobody wants anything less than extra strength. Extra strength is the absolute minimum. You can't even get strength. Strength is out now. It's all extra strength. Some people not satisfied with extra, they want maximum. Give me the maximum strength. Give me the maximum allowable human dosage. Figure out what will kill me and then back it off a little bit. And why does that pharmacist have to be 2.5 feet higher than everybody else? Who the hell is this guy? Clear out, everybody. I'm working with pills up here. I'm taking them from this big bottle, and then I'm going to put them in a little bottle. That's my whole job. I can't be down on the floor with you people. Yes, I'd like to get this prescription filled, please. All right, but you wait down there. No one comes up here but me. It's that little bit of arrogance in the medical community I think we could all live without. Like when you go to see the doctor, you don't see the actual doctor first. You must wait in the waiting room. There's no chance of not waiting. That's the name of the room. The doctors are all back there. Well, we can't take them now. We've already got this room. And you sit there, you pretend you're reading your little magazine. You're actually looking at the other people. I wonder what he's got. That guy's a goner. Then they call. You get very excited when they call you. Because you think now you're going to see the doctor. But you're not. Now you're going into the next smaller waiting room. Now you don't even have your magazine. Now you got your pants around your ankles. You're sitting on that butcher paper they pull out over the table. Sometimes I bring a pickle with me and I put it next to me right there on the table. I don't know. In case the doctor wants to fold the whole thing up for a to-go order. Get your pants off and get in there and I will tell you what I think. Doctors always want your pants off. Take your pants off. Doctor would like to see you with no pants. Just get them off. It's my head. I said take your pants off. But I hate the extra weight, so maybe I'll start screwing around with some of his stuff, you know? Maybe I'll turn that thing up a little bit. Whatever the hell that does. Take all the tongue depressors out, lick them all, put them all back in. Yeah, two can play at this waiting game. Just once I'd like to say to the doctor, you know what? I'm not ready for you yet. Why don't you go back in your little office? I'll be in a minute. And get your pants off. Then we'll see what's what. Why does the doctor need that little office for anyway? You know, his books, little stupid aquarium there. I guess he doesn't want people to see him looking stuff up. What the hell was that? Jesus Christ. That was kind of gross. That wasn't the tube or the circle. A friend of mine is going in for a nose job next week. Guy. Nose job. You know what the technical term for a nose job is? Well, of course you do. It's New York, everybody. Rhinoplasty. Rhino. Now, this guy is aware he has a bit of a problem. He's obviously sensitive about it. That's why he made the appointment. Do we need to compare him to a rhinoceros? When you go for a hair transplant, they don't say, we're going to perform a cuboidectomy on you, Mr. Johnson. We feel the chromedomia has advanced to a level we term skinheadia. These are all medical terms that you don't need to understand. Of course, everybody wants to look their best. We're all out there. Everybody wants to look good. Guys, gals, sexuality. I am a single guy, by the way. There are no other guys attached to me. Thank you very much. Thank you. I love you too. But I do feel the need to see other people. I got engaged about 10 or so years ago. Didn't want to get married. That was the only closest I got. I can tell you this, if you're engaged and you don't want to get married, it's a little tense. It's like you're on that first hill of the roller coaster, but you don't really want to go on the ride. You're just going click, 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 click. I was best man at a wedding one time. That was pretty good. Pretty good title, I thought, best man. I thought it was a bit much. I thought we'd have the groom and a pretty good man. That's more than enough. If I'm the best man, why is she marrying him? Had to wear the tuxedo, which I'm convinced was invented by a woman. Well, they're all the same. We might as well dress them all the same. The tuxedo also functions as a wedding safety device for the bride. In case the groom chickens out, everybody could just take one step over and the ceremony continues. That's why they don't say, do you take Dave Williams to be your lawfully wedded husband? They say, do you take this man? But men and women will never understand each other. We all know that. It's just not gonna happen. Just forget it. I know I will not understand women. I know I will never be able to understand how a woman could take boiling hot wax, pour it on her upper thighs, rip the hair out by the root, and still be afraid of a spider. I'm not spending any more time working on that. And I know women don't understand men. I know there are women that are looking at me right now going, I wonder what goes on in that little brain of his. I bet you I could manipulate that brain. I bet you could. I bet you women would like to know what men are really thinking. The truth, the honest truth of what men are really thinking. Because I could tell you. Would you like to know? All right, I'll tell you. Nothing. We're not thinking anything. We're just walking around, looking around. This is the only natural inclination of man, to just kind of check stuff out. We work because they force us to, but other than that, this is the really only thing we want to do. We like women, we want women, but that's pretty much as far as we've thought. That's why we're honking car horns, yelling from construction sites. These are the best ideas we've had so far. Honking the car horn amazes me. This has got to be just the last living brain cell in this guy's skull that comes up with this idea. I don't understand. It's so awful. She's on the street. He's in the car. Beep, beep. I think I made my point. What is she supposed to do? Kick off the heel, start running after the car? Grab onto the bumper? Car comes to a stop. It's a good thing you honked. I had no idea how you felt. Why do men behave in these ways? Why are we rude, obnoxious, getting drunk, falling down, peeling rubber, making kissing noises out the window? Why are we like this? I know what you ladies are thinking. No, no, not my guy. I'm working with him. He's coming along. No, he's not. He's not coming anywhere. We men know, no matter how poorly we behave, it seems we will somehow end up with women anyway. Look around this room. Look at all the men you see with lovely women. Do you think these are special men? Gifted men? One of a kind men? They're the same jerks and idiots that I'm talking about. They're doing just fine. Men as an organization are getting more women than any other group working anywhere in the world today. Wherever women are, we have men looking into the situation right now. We explored the Earth looking for women, even went to the moon just to see if there was any women there. That's why we brought that little car. Why would you bring a car unless there's some chance of going on a date? What the hell were they doing with a car on the goddamn moon? You're on the moon already! Isn't that far enough? There is no more male idea in the history of the universe than why don't we fly up to the moon and drive around? That is the essence of male thinking right there. See, because all men kind of think of themselves as like low-level superheroes in their own world. I'm not even supposed to be telling you this. But when men are growing up and they're reading about Batman, Spider-Man, Superman, these aren't fantasies. These are options. This is the deep inner secret truth of the male mind. I'll give you a perfect example of what I'm talking about. Did you ever see a guy out on the highway moving a mattress tied to the roof of the car? Without fail, he's got the arm out the window holding the mattress. This is classic male idiot superhero thinking. This moron believes if the wind catches this huge rectangle at 70 miles an hour, I got it, I got it. Don't worry about it. I'm using my arm. But I'm sure there are many dates going on in this room right now. Dating is not easy. What is a date really but a job interview that lasts all night? The only difference between a date and a job interview is not many job interviews. Is there a chance you'll end up naked at the end of it? Well, Bill, the boss thinks you're the man for the position. Why don't you strip down and meet some of the people you'll be working with? Sex doesn't make anything any easier. Even only makes it more complicated. Women have two types of orgasms, the actual ones and the ones that they make up on their own. And I can give you the male point of view on this, which is we're fine with it. You do whatever the hell it is you gotta do. To a man, sex is like a car accident anyway. And determining a female orgasm is like being asked, what did you see after the car went out of control? Well, I remember I heard a lot of screeching noises. I was facing the wrong way at one point. And in the end, my body was thrown clear. I'll tell you what I like about Chinese people. They're hanging in there with the chopsticks, aren't they? You know they've seen the fork. They're staying with the sticks. I'm impressed by that. I don't know how they missed it. Chinese farmer gets up, works in the field with a shovel all day. Shovel, spoon, come on. There it is. You're not plowing 40 acres with a couple of pool cues. And why is McDonald's still counting? This is really insecure, isn't it? 40 jillion, 80 million, zillion, billion, killion, tillion. What is this? Does it mean anything to anyone? 89 billion sold. Okay. I'll have one. I would love to meet the chairman of the board of McDonald's, just say to him, look, we all get it. You've sold a lot of hamburgers, whatever the hell the number is. Just put up a sign, McDonald's, we're doing very well. I don't need to hear about every goddamn one of them. What is their ultimate goal? To have cows just surrendering voluntarily or something? Showing up at the door, we like to turn ourselves in, we see the sign. We realize we have very little chance out there. We'd like to be a happy meal if that's at all possible. I was in London about a month ago. The World Cup was going on. I enjoy any sporting event where nations get involved. I find that the most exciting. The Olympics is really my favorite sporting event, although I think I have a problem with that silver medal. I think if I was an Olympic athlete, I would rather come in last than win the silver, if you think about it. You know, you win the gold, you feel good. You win the bronze, you think, well, at least I got something. But you win that silver, that's like, congratulations, you almost won. Of all the losers, you came in first of that group. You're the number one loser. No one lost ahead of you. And they don't lose by much. You know, these short races, 0.03, 0.02. I don't know how they live with that the rest of their lives, because you got to tell the story. Everyone wants to hear the story. Wow, congratulations, silver medal. Did you trip? Did you not hear the gun go off? Tell us what happened. It's 0.01. You know, people say, what was the difference in the margin there? What was it? Well, it was like from now to now. I trained, I worked out, I exercised my entire life. I never had a date, I never had a drink, I never had a beer. I was doing push-ups since I was a fetus. I flew halfway around the world. Everybody I knew in my whole life was there. The guy shot off the gun. And they always have that photo finish. You know, the photo finish was always silver, gold. This is the whole race. Gold, silver, bronze, dead last. Greatest guy in the world, never heard of him. And, you know, guys gotta be thinking, if I had a pimple, I would have won. So many events at the Olympics don't make sense to me. I don't understand their connection to any reality. Like in the Winter Olympics, they have that biathlon. You know that one that combines cross-country skiing with shooting a gun? How many alpine snipers are into this? But ski, shoot a gun, ski, bang, bang, bang. To me, it's like combining swimming and strangle a guy. Why don't we have that? That makes absolutely as much sense to me. Just put people in the pool at the end of each lane for the swimmers. And that other one that I love is the luge. You know the luge where the guy wears the slick suit? This is on the bobsled run, but it's not even a sled. It's just Bob. It's just a human being hanging on for their life. This is the whole sport. Just, ah. Oh, he pointed his toes. Oh, this guy's a tremendous athlete. The luge is the only sport I've ever seen that you could have people competing in it against their will, and it would be exactly the same. You know, if they were just grabbing people off the street, hey, 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 what is this? I don't want to be in the luge. You know, you put the helmet on them, you wouldn't really hear them screaming, just, you're in the luge, buddy. World record. Didn't even want to do it. I want to see that event next year, the involuntary luge. I consider myself something of a sportsman. I like sporty type things. Scuba diving, did that in Australia. That was a lot of fun. Another great activity where your main goal is to not die. That's really all I was thinking about the entire day. Just don't die, don't die, don't die, don't die. There's a fish, there's a rock, who cares, don't die. I don't wanna die, don't let me die. Let's swim and breathe and live. Because living is good and dying not as good. So I go with this guy, Mr. Scuba Guy. Takes me to the store, makes sure I buy everything I need. I had the waterproof wallet I got now. Nylon, in case we run into a sea turtle that can break a 50. Waterproof watch, that's important. Gee, I'm completely out of oxygen, and look at the time. Geez, now I'm dead and I'm late. I like these somewhat high-risk things, the scuba, I've gone hang gliding, I've gone skydiving. I like a little bit of risk. I don't know, maybe that's why I do this. I saw a thing, actually, a study that said speaking in front of a crowd is considered the number one fear of the average person. I found that amazing. Number two was death. Death is number two? This means to the average person, if you have to be at a funeral, you would rather be in the casket than doing the eulogy. Skydiving was definitely the scariest thing I've ever done. Let me ask you this question in regards to the skydiving. What is the point of the helmet in the skydiving? I mean, can you kind of make it? You jump out of that plane, that chute doesn't open. The helmet is now wearing you for protection. Later on, the helmet's talking with the other helmets, going, it's a good thing he was there or I would have hit the ground directly. You never jump out of a plane unless you got a human being strapped underneath you. That's basic safety. There are many things that we could point to as proof that the human being is not smart. The helmet is my personal favorite. The fact that we had to invent the helmet. Now, why did we invent the helmet? Well, because we were participating in many activities that were cracking our heads. We looked at the situation. We chose not to avoid these activities, but to just make little plastic hats so that we can continue our head-cracking lifestyles. The only thing dumber than the helmet is the helmet law, the point of which is to protect a brain that is functioning so poorly, it's not even trying to stop the cracking of the head that it's in. At least the helmet is functional clothing. I appreciate that. Clothing, to me, for the most part, is just a tremendous pain in the ass. If you think of the amount of time, mental effort, physical energy that goes into your clothes, picking them, buying them, does that go with that? I don't think I can wear that. I'm missing a button. This is dirty. I got to get something new. That's up my ass. Can't wear this. I think we should all wear the same exact clothes because it seems to be what happens eventually anyway. Anytime you see a movie or a TV show where there's people from the future, or another planet, they're all wearing the same outfit. I think the decision just gets made. All right, everyone, from now on, it's just gonna be the one-piece silver suit with the V-stripe and the boots. That's the outfit. We're gonna be visiting other planets. We wanna look like a team here. The individuality thing is over. The dry cleaner I can't stand, because I don't think he's doing it. I don't know what goes on back there, but I cannot conceive of such a thing as actual dry cleaning. We all accept it because we see the stores everywhere. But think about it. Dry? What is dry? You can't clean something dry. What do? Tap it, shake it, blow on it? There's got to be some kind of a liquid back there. Did you ever get something on your clothes and get it off with a fingernail? That's dry cleaning. That is the only dry cleaning. I brought this guy in a suede jacket, got spots on it because I was in the rain. Says there's nothing we can do. Water ruins leather. Now, aren't cows outdoors a lot of the time? When it rains, do the cows go up to the farmhouse? Hey, let us in. We're all wearing leather out here. Hey, open up, man. I'm suede. I'm living suede. Dry clean only is definitely the only warning label that human beings actually respect. You know, they'll look at cigarettes, this will give you cancer, kill you, kids, everything, ah, screw it. I'll do whatever the hell I want. Don't drink this medicine and operate heavy machinery. Oh, glug, 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 who cares? That's for people that don't know what the hell they're doing. I'm a pro. But if you have something that's dry clean only and somebody goes to put it in the washing machine, don't put it in the washing machine, it's dry clean only, you're crazy, out of your mind. It is amazing what people will believe. I mean, I watch these infomercials late at night. If it gets late enough, the products start to look good to me. I have actually found myself sitting there thinking, you know, I don't think I have a knife that can cut through a shoe. don't think any of my knives are good enough to cut through shoes. I'm gonna get this knife and cut my shoes up. That seems pretty good. I think the dumbest thing you can think late at night is, you know, I'm gonna get this thing and get in shape. You know, it's like 3 a.m, you got potato chip crumbs on your shirt there. You got one eye open, one sock hanging off of the foot. You go, yeah, I'm gonna start working out with this thing. I'm gonna order this thing. This is all I need to get in shape. This is a fantastic device. Rip off. Can't stop getting ripped off. We're gonna get ripped off. We think we're not. We think we're very clever. We think we're gonna foil the crooks. You know, we go to the beach, go in the water, put your wallet in the sneaker, who's gonna know? What criminal mind could penetrate this fortress of security? I put it down by the toe, they never look there. They check the heels, they move on. Well, you ever move a TV set in the backseat of your car, then I gotta leave the car on the street for a few minutes, so you put a sweater over the TV. It's a couple of sweaters, that's all. One of them is square with an antenna coming out of it. So feeble, the things we come up with, the foil crooks. The wanted posters at the post office. You're there, you got your package. You're trying to mail something. This guy's wanted in 12 states. Yeah, now what? Okay. You know, I check the guy standing in line behind me. If it's not him, that's pretty much all I can do. Why don't they just hold on to this guy when they're taking his picture? The guy's there with you. Come out from behind the camera, grab him! No, we don't do that. We take their picture, we let them go. That's how we get the front and side shot. The front is his face, the side is him leaving. Why don't they put the pictures of the criminals on the postage stamps? Let the postman look for them. He's out there walking around all day. He's got the uniform on. Can't he do something? Oh, we got another letter for you here, Mr. Johnson. I think that's him. So we really did have a good time on, this is the end of a long tour, and when you're on the road, you always have to do whatever anyone suggests that day, because you have nothing to do, and you have no ideas. So you do whatever anyone suggests. So a couple weeks ago, we go to the track. I did that a couple of times in my life. Betting on the horses, you can't possibly win. I don't even understand what we're betting on. I mean, do the horses know that it's a race? Are they aware? What is going on here? After the race of the horses walking back to the stable, I was third, I was first, I was ninth. I think they're thinking, oat bag, I get my oat bag now. Oat bag time. I got a bet on this idiot? I mean, I'm sure the horses have some idea that the jockey is in a big hurry. I mean, he's on him, he's hitting him with the thing, he's going, come on, come on, this is obviously, he's in a hurry, the jockey's in a hurry. But the horse must get to the end and go, we were just here, what was the point of that? This is where we were. That was the longest possible route you could take. Why didn't we just stay here? We would have been first. I'll tell you one thing the horses definitely do not know. They do not know if you should accidentally trip and break your leg at any point during the race, we blow your brains out. I think they're missing that little tidbit of information. I think if they knew that, you'd see some mighty careful stepping coming down that home stretch. Take it easy, take it easy. You win, I'll place, whatever. The important thing is your health. I've gone horseback riding. I can't do that. And they don't give you the really good horses when you're not good at it, I found out. The guy says to me, what level rider would you say that you are? I said, I don't know, zero, nothing, whatever the system is. I can't do it. Is that clear enough for you? I'm going where the horse wants to go. That's my level. Of course, they hear that, they start looking around. All right, is glue stick back yet? How about almost dead? Why don't you saddle him up? So I get on this U-shaped, lightning quick steed. I got the only horse. You could put your feet flat on the ground while you're riding it. I'm riding a hammock here. Looking up at my friends. I don't feel like we all got the same kind of horse here. It's kind of a secure feeling. I could walk along with him if I wanted. But and the horse wasn't too thrilled with having me either, because I don't know what the hell I'm doing. So he takes control. Going this way, going that way. I'm trying to, come on, come on. Then they just stop, you know, and you're, what is it, you know? And they look up at you. Chill out, hop along, I know the trail. Yeah, I'm here every goddamn day, okay? And I really appreciate the kicking while I'm taking a leak, too. Yeah, thanks a lot. That really improves the already wonderful life that I have. People either sitting on me or kicking me while I'm peeing. I'm living in a paradise here at the ranch. I get out of a car that has 300 horsepower so I can sit on an animal that has one. Why do we even use the term horsepower? Is that to further humiliate horses? The space shuttle rockets have 20 million horsepower. Is there any point in still comparing it to the horses? Or any chance of going back to using rockets with horses, trying to keep track of how many we're going to need? Hey, horses, a rocket engine's broke down. Can you get 20 million friends together really fast?
20 million, that's a lot.
They make glue out of horses. I don't know who started that. Who saw that potential? That's pretty amazing to me. What are you working in a stationery store? A horse walks by. Hey, wait a minute. I think he could be glue. How do we pick out the really sticky ones? You leave that to me. What about that one over there? He's weaving around. He looks like he's out of his mind. He'll be crazy glue. To me, the toughest part of that horse life is that trailer. Why do they make the horse trailer like that? Is that the best way to move a horse out on the highway? With their huge, fat, disgusting rear ends right in my face? Do the horses like it? They're probably standing in the back going, do you feel a draft, Bill? I can't see anything back there, but it's awfully breezy, isn't it? You don't think our huge, fat asses are hanging out the back of this truck, do you? Why the hell would they do that to us? They already ride us around and kick us while we're peeing. Why stick our ass out of a truck? But I have fully adjusted to the road. I like hotels. I enjoy tiny soap. I pretend that it's normal soap and my muscles are huge. And you can always tell when you're in a fine quality luxury hotel when the TV is bolted to a solid steel beam and welded into the wall. Is this a big problem in the hotel business? People coming up to the desk, I'd like to check out. The main thing is the bathroom, the shower, that's got to be good. That's why I don't like to stay with people on the road. I don't want to be in other people's showers. I never know how to operate them. You know what I mean? You can never get the ratios right on the dials. Sometimes a 1/16 of an inch is 1,000 degrees. You gotta get out of the way of the water. There's always that little hair stuck on the wall too. And you wanna get rid of it, but you don't wanna touch it. I don't know how it got up that high in the first place. Maybe it's got a life of its own. So you gotta aim the shower head at the hair. That never works. You gotta get a pool of water from under the shower and over to the hair. Get it down a foot at a time like this. The hair is hanging on. But we have to fight these battles. We're all alone in the bathroom. Whatever goes wrong, you have to handle it. You ever go to a big party, go in the bathroom, flush the toilet, and the water starts coming up? This is the most frightening moment in the life of a human being. You'll do anything to stop this. You'll lose your mind, start talking to the toilet. No, please don't do this to me. No, come on, you know this is not my responsibility. I didn't make this happen. I'll get you the blue thing, the man in the boat. Just let me off the hook this one time. Thank you very much. You've been a wonderful audience. Thank you for coming.
Can't believe this swinging life is what I've always wanted. I forgot all of that when you walked through the door. Bachelorhood always sounded so good, but now I'm not so sure. Suddenly, I'm not so free for the latest femme du jour. You can't believe this swinging life is I've always wanted to doubt the fact that I really wanted more. I'll get my hand, give a hand to the band, and baby, I think you'll find that I just left this swinging life behind.